Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear stories from Dan Novak, Gregory Stachel, Dan Friedell, and Gena Bennett. Then, John Russell presents a new Everyday Grammar. But first, 4 years ago, India banned TikTok. Dan Novak has a report on how this ban differs from the possible TikTok ban in the US.
The hugely popular Chinese app TikTok may be forced out of the United States. Wednesday, President Joe Biden signed into law a conditional ban of the video sharing app. India banned TikTok almost 4 years ago. Here is a look at what happened there. In June 2020, TikTok users in India said goodbye to the app, operated by Chinese internet company ByteDance. India banned the popular app suddenly, following a deadly military clash with India along their shared border. India banned many other Chinese apps at the same time. Ties between the two Asian countries hit a new low. The Indian government said it ordered the ban for security reasons and privacy protection. The Indian public mostly supported the ban. The message from the government was, "How can we allow Chinese companies to do business in India when we're in the middle of a military standoff?" said Nikhil Pawa. He is a digital policy expert and founder of technology news website Medianama. Just months before the ban, India restricted investment by Chinese companies, Pawa added. "Today, India has banned over 500 Chinese apps to date," he said. At the time, India had about 200 million TikTok users, the most outside of China. The company also employed thousands of Indians. TikTok users and content creators, however, needed a place to go. Within months, Google created YouTube Shorts, and Instagram created its Reels feature. Both were similar to the short-form video creation that TikTok is known for. Pawa said those companies captured most of the market that TikTok had vacated. Winnie Sangma misses posting videos on TikTok and earning a bit of money. But after the ban, he moved to Instagram and now has 15,000 followers. "I have built up followers on Instagram too, and I am making money from it, but the experience isn't like how it used to be on TikTok," he said. The US measure gives ByteDance, the app's parent company, 9 months to sell it. If this does not happen, TikTok will be banned. It would take at least a year before the ban goes into effect. However, the measure is expected to face legal battles that could delay the process. In India, the process was quick. TikTok and other companies were given time to answer questions on privacy and security, but by January 2021, a permanent ban was in place. "The situation in the US is different," said Pawa. "In India, TikTok decided not to go to court, but the US is a bigger revenue market for them." Pawa added that with American free speech protections, it's not going to be as easy for the US to do this as it was for India. As Chinese apps spread across the world, Pawa said countries should reduce their dependence on Chinese companies. He said Chinese apps can create a national security risk. Afghanistan, Nepal, and Pakistan also banned TikTok. Many countries in Europe restrict the app as well. Chinese intelligence law and its cybersecurity law can allow Chinese apps to work in the interest of their own security. That creates a situation of distrust, and it becomes a national security risk for others, said Pawa. There should be different rules for democratic countries and for authoritarian regimes where companies can act as an extension of the state, he added. I'm Dan Novak.
Minnesota is one of several states where lawmakers are considering laws to make it harder for people to get books removed from public libraries. The Washington and Maryland state legislatures have already passed laws this year, while Illinois did so last year. The American Library Association says over 4,200 books in school and public libraries were targeted with restrictions in 2023. That is an increase from about 2,600 books in 2022. In 2023, 47% of books that were challenged by members of the public had racial or sexual subject matter that was termed LGBTQ+. Restrictions on books have increased in some states. Librarians and administrators in states with restrictions worry about fines, legal action, and prison sentences if they provide books that the public considers inappropriate. This year, lawmakers in more than 15 states have introduced bills that place restrictions on libraries and punishment for breaking rules. Some parents and activists object to books containing strong sexual subjects being bought and lent by public libraries and public school libraries. They say such material is inappropriate, especially for young readers. National groups such as Moms for Liberty say parents have the right to prevent their children from seeing material that they consider bad. Every Library is a political action group for libraries, which aims to fight restrictions. Every Library says several states are considering different bans on restricting books. States considering such bans include California, Connecticut, Delaware, Georgia, Kansas, Massachusetts, Missouri, New York, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, and Vermont. However, bans on book bans appear unlikely to pass in states where they have little public support. One bill failed in New Mexico this year, for example. A law barring restrictions on books is awaiting Maryland Governor Wes Moore's signature. Washington State Governor Jay Inslee signed a bill that makes it more difficult to remove books the public finds offensive. That includes material that deals with race and LGBTQ+ ideas. A bill is being considered in New Jersey that would protect librarians from civil or criminal responsibility for the materials they put in public libraries. Some proposals are called Freedom to Read Acts. Martha Hickson is a librarian at North Hunterdon High School in New Jersey. She said freedom to read is important. She said reading is voluntary. She added, students can choose to read, not read, or totally ignore everything in this library. I'm Gregory Stachel.
Brazil's state-run oil company, Petrobras, wants to look for oil near the nation's northeastern coast.
IBAMA is Brazil's environmental agency. The agency denied Petrobras' first proposal to do exploratory drilling last year over environmental worries. The indigenous people who live in the area also objected. But some political leaders, including President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, seem to support the oil company's appeal. Last September, the president said the company should be able to research the oil possibilities in the area. He said it was a national interest. Energy Minister Alexandre Silveira recently said Brazil should know the potential of what exists along the northeastern coast. The support has energized Petrobras' leader, Jean-Paul Prates. Prates talked about the area, known as the Equatorial Margin, as perhaps the last frontier of oil for Brazil. The company wants to start looking for oil in the area called Foz do Amazonas. It has that name because it is in the area of the mouth of the Amazon River. The area is thought to be similar to places off the coast of the South American country of Guyana, which is being explored by the Exxon Oil Company. The head of IBAMA is Rodrigo Agostinho. He said the agency would make a decision about giving Petrobras a license to explore the area early this year, but the decision has been delayed. Reporting by Reuters news agency describes a growing indigenous campaign against Petrobras's appeal.
FUNAI is Brazil's agency for indigenous protection. Last December, the group asked IBAMA to carry out studies on the effects of drilling in Foz do Amazonas. The studies must happen before IBAMA can give a license to Petrobras. In addition, an indigenous group called the CCPIO, representing 60 villages in the area, asked Brazilian federal government lawyers to look into the potential drilling license. They said their rights were being violated. In 2022, the government lawyers, or prosecutors, slowed down the process. They said IBAMA needed to consult the local communities. Documents seen by Reuters show the CCPIO asked the prosecutors to oversee 13 months of talks starting last December. If the process continues without a change, the soonest Brazil could permit Petrobras to drill would be 2025. However, the country will be hosting the COP30 climate meeting, and it is unlikely Brazil would want to announce a new drilling plan at the same time. Petrobras said a decision needs to be made and the time for talks with indigenous people has passed. The oil company said the consultations should have happened at the beginning of the process. However, CCPIO and federal lawyers said a consultation must happen before drilling is permitted. De Silva's government promised to protect the Amazon area and indigenous groups. However, The president also knows the value of oil development. Reuters says he is trying to balance both sides. Silveira, the energy minister, said a single successful drilling area could produce 5.6 billion barrels of oil. The discovery would be Brazil's biggest in more than 10 years. Petrobras argues that a drilling area 175 kilometers off the coast will not affect the indigenous people of northern Brazil. But activists say drilling could hurt the water environment and limit the native people's ability to fish and make a living.
The CCPIO noted that it is not opposed to the search for oil, but it wants to be consulted before the exploration begins. Brazil signed an international agreement that says governments must talk with native groups before starting a project that might change their lifestyles. The news of a possible oil project starting next year has gotten the attention of migrant workers. A lawmaker in Amapá State, Inácio Monteiro, said workers are arriving in the town of Oiapoque looking for jobs in the oil industry, although there are no jobs yet. Monteiro said he talks with indigenous leaders all the time about the good oil could bring, including better social programs, more infrastructure like roads and bridges, new jobs, and money from taxes. However, local people like 25-year-old Luene Carapuna are concerned. She told a group at the COP28 climate meeting in Dubai that politicians and Petrobras are trying to silence her people. She said her people are worried that an oil spill could bring in polluted water. Indigenous leaders also worry that the support for protecting their land and waters is disappearing. They point to a 2023 hearing that Monteiro called just days after the first denial of Petrobras' license. Top leaders in Amapá State came together in Oiapoque to push again for the license. There were reports that a man wearing a white shirt and a traditional indigenous head covering said the native people supported drilling. However, CCPIO leaders said the man did not speak for them. CCPIO's coordinator, Cacique Edmilson Oliveira, said, "This is very concerning. That's why we are saying that we already feel threatened." He said, "Petrobras misreports the statements of indigenous leaders. We never sat down and reached an agreement for approval," he added. I'm Dan Friedell.
And I'm Gena Bennett.
We have a question for you. What do countries, economies, mathematics, and the news have in common? There are several ways to answer the question, but today we are thinking about this connection. Large numbers. Large numbers, say a million and up, appear all the time in everyday situations, and especially in news reports. These large numbers come along with a kind of noun known as a count noun. In today's everyday grammar, we will learn about the history and usage of large numbers. We will look at some modern examples and then give you a chance to practice writing about large numbers. Let's begin our story with the word million. It has a connection with 1,000, as we will see. But first, we make a trip to the ancient past. We can clean off the dusty books of history and find clues about the beginnings of million. We see mille, a Latin word which suggests 1,000. We find evidence of mille through time. We have the Italian milione and million in Old French. We find million in English appearing around the late 1300s with the meaning of 1,000 thousands. Million serves as the starting point for even larger numbers to come. We get a billion, a word that mixes by, a word element that suggests the idea of two, with the word million. Later, we get trillion, a word that mixes tri, a word element that suggests three, and the word million. The story of large numbers in English is complex. There are so-called long and short-scale systems. But you do not need to worry about such issues. For our purposes, we can use the modern American definitions from Merriam-Webster. We arrive at these definitions. A million is equal to 1,000 times 1,000. A billion is equal to 1,000 times 1,000,000. A trillion is equal to 1,000 times 1,000,000,000. The central idea is to define bigger numbers, like a million, billion, or trillion, based on some relationship with 1,000. Now that we have some definitions in mind, we can turn to some questions. Why might large numbers matter? Here is one answer. Large numbers, millions, billions, trillions, appear all the time in the news. The large number is often what draws attention or creates interest. You might also be wondering how the discussion of large numbers connects to grammar. Here, the idea is less about the numbers themselves and more about the things, in this case the nouns, that the numbers describe. In particular, we use these large numbers to describe count nouns, nouns that we are able to count with numbers. And in the news, there are several count nouns commonly used with large numbers. Dollars, people, and years. Here are a few examples. Consider this headline published earlier this year by VOA News.
U.S. national debt hits record $34 trillion as Congress gears up for funding fight.
Here we have the number, $34 trillion, describing a count noun, dollars. The dollar is the official money of the United States. But news stories in your country might use other kinds of money, such as the euro, the peso, and so on. News stories about trade, finance, and economies are very likely to contain this structure, large number plus the name of the currency. Now consider this section from a science story that recently appeared on the VOA Learning English website.
Marine reptiles lived in the world's oceans at the same time that dinosaurs lived on the land. Ichthyosaurs disappeared 90 million years ago.
In this example, we have the large number 90 million describing the count noun years. Science stories, particularly stories about ancient times and outer space, often center on a point in time long ago. So, keep an eye out for this structure, large number plus years, or years ago. Finally, let's consider a short example from another VOA Learning English report. The subject this time is an English test. We learn about the number of people who took the test.
The 2023 EF English Proficiency Index, EPI, ranks countries and areas by English proficiency. The index is based on test results from 2.2 million people in 113 countries.
Here, we have the number 2.2 million describing the count noun people. Stories about studies, elections, populations, and so on often involve this structure: large number plus people. In today's lesson, we covered a lot of territory. We looked into the past and explored the present. And we can report that we used about 800 words to present the subject of large numbers and count nouns. We will end today's lesson with a call to action. We would like you to link the ideas we have explored with something connected to your country. Please write us 1 to 2 sentences about a large number, million, billion, or trillion, that connects with an event or situation in your country or area. For example, you might write, "My country's GDP is around $10 trillion," or "My government spends $100 billion on healthcare." You can send your sentences in an email to learningenglish@voanews.com. In a future lesson, we will give feedback on some of the messages we receive. I'm John Russell.
Just heard this week's Everyday Grammar. Now, John Russell joins me to talk more about the lesson. Hi, John. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
I wanted to ask you, was there one element that you were not able to include in today's lesson that you would like to talk about now?
I'm glad you asked. Due to time limits, I wasn't able to give a deeper explanation of why the large number definitions matter. The reason the definitions are important is because they can be confusing.
How so?
Well, consider a billion. It is made up of bi, a word-forming element meaning two, and a million. So you might think that a billion is the same as a million times a million. But that is not the case, at least in terms of our modern American definition.
If we check in a word history book, such as the Online Etymology Dictionary, we see that a billion had the meaning of a million millions in the past. But in our modern American usage, a billion means 1,000 millions.
That's right. A somewhat tricky point to understand. That is why we spent time highlighting the importance of 1,000 and its connection to larger numbers, a million, a billion, and so on.
That's a lot to think about, John. Well, thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me. See you next time.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.